So I think probably we should start. Hello, dear participants. Let me start the second day of our conference. And first, I would like to introduce our participants. Actually, our panel is devoted to the history of literary criticism in Soviet Ukraine in the 1920s and 1930s, and a little bit further, as Alexander Dmitriev will talk about Alexander Beletsky of 1940s. The panel will consist of three presentations, participants are Oksana Pashko. Let me introduce her in a few words. She will present on a very interesting topic and not much researched. The Academy formation of the Sociology of Literature and the Ukrainian Literary Criticism of the 1920s, Sociology of Literary Styles and Reader Perception. Oksana graduated from Taras Shevchenko University, then she obtained her PhD at the Institute of Literature of National Academy of Science of Ukraine. She wrote her PhD entitled as The Reception of Sergei Yesenin Works in Ukraine in 1920s. Her research interests are Ukrainian and Russian relations, literary relations in the 20th century. Also, she engaged in a study of Ukrainian and Russian modernism and sociology of literature. Now Oksana is an associated professor of National University of Kyiv-Mohyla Academy, the Department of Literature. Next presentation will be held by Natalia Vusatsuk-Katenka, and she graduated from the National University of Kyiv-Mohyla Academy. Her research interests are Ukrainian modernism, history of literary criticism of the 1920s, literary theory. She is the author of numerous publications of the phenomenon of Kyiv neoclassics. And actually her talk will be devoted to these problematics. The title is The Literary Criticism of Kyiv Neoclassicists Between Formalism and Sociologism. Natalia now is up to defend her PhD thesis. And the next speaker will be Alexander Dmitriev. Actually, my co-author. he's a historian and leading research fellow of Politaev Institute and assistant professor of the School of Historical Science of the National University of High School of Economics. His research interests are modern Russian and European intellectual history. And a series of intellectual development. I should say that today's our panel is a little bit differ from the previous ones, as we will have not only presenters and moderation, but also we decided to make a kind of a brief introduction to the problematics I will talk about. So I will have probably like first 20 minutes just to describe the context and different important aspects, which I suppose we will have time to discuss. And the last one, aspect is our time schedule. Yeah, I suggest each of us has 30 minutes for presentation. My suggestion is to discuss all the presentations after the last speaker, I will explain it. The first, as we have like very tight and very linked presentations, yes, so it's better for us to discuss all in one set, yeah, not to divide, because like the questions I may address to, for example, Oksana or Natalia, probably they could be also addressed to Alexander. I also suggest we to make small breaks after the Oksana's presentation, like for 10-15 minutes, and after the Alexander presentation, yeah? As we have 3.5 hours, so I think it's better to have some time to think about what will be the next. I will share my screen. Here. Just I will do like this, yeah. As I was told, our panel is devoted to the history of literary criticism in Soviet Ukraine in the 1920s and 1930s. And today we are going to talk about the different aspects of the development of and correlation between Marxist and formalist approaches to the literary criticism. I want to emphasize on the picture I decided to take for the my brief presentation. It's a not realized project of Ukrainian architect Viktor Trotsenko from 1929. Here you may read Kharkiv do projektu planu Майдану Дзержинського. So it's not realized project of the Maidan Square of the Kharkiv. Yeah. I will try to answer the question of the importance. Why it's important to discuss literary criticism in Soviet Ukraine of this period, and why the reconstruction of the history of literary theory and criticism and the correlation between formalism and Marxism is worth to talk about. Except the obvious scientific curiosity, probably first I should say that this this topic is not much explored then, in comparison, for example, to the Ukrainian literary and art avant-garde or Ukrainian modernism. I mean the history of the institutionalization of national science and humanities, but not as an isolated field of knowledge, but in its close connection to the reconstruction of intellectual biographies of the numerous of literary critics that took part in the process of nation building. Above all of this, I think that the understanding of this problematics opens to us much broader perspective. First of all, it's necessary for rethinking of the formal theory and its influence on the development of literary theories in Eastern and Central Europe, as Ukrainian intellectual landscape is the part of the general context. Second, it could provide us with a better understanding of history of regional cultural identities. And here I mean not only Ukraine, but other national republics of Soviet Union. Also, it could help us to uncover several layers of the historical and political context of the Soviet 1920s. Here I would like to follow the conference agenda and to say a couple of words about the simultaneity and non-simultaneity of the ongoing process of Ukrainian literary studies during the 1920s. I mean the processes which we are going to talk about that from the first glance were developed simultaneous in comparison to the metropolitan center or centers, if you wish, and even synchronically, but indeed they had different content, tools, and aims. And to be more precise, I will now explain what I mean. I would like to make two steps back in chronology of our presentation to talk about the very important period of Ukrainian national history. I mean the period between the collapse of Russian Empire and the establishment of Soviet power on the part of the territory of contemporary Ukraine. And here I mean, of course, the proclamation of Ukrainian People's Republic, but not only. I would like to talk about 1913-1920. The First World War and the fall of the Tsarist regime of 1917 created a fundamentally new political situation for the implementation of the independence of Ukraine and for the establishment of Ukrainian science at a new institutional level. Already in the spring, summer 1917, together with the national political uprising, the organization of Ukrainian scientific life began to gain its strength. There were created people's universities in Ukraine and Kharkiv, so-called Ukrainsky Narodny Universitet. It was created in Kyiv and Kharkiv first, as well as the departments of Ukrainian studies in Ukrainian Ukrainistika. They were opened there. In my presentation, you may read about the Ukrainian People's University in Kyiv. I wouldn't read it with you. But also the network of new libraries, museums, and educational centers were expanded at that time. In autumn 1918, the government of Getman Skoropadsky founded the Ukrainian Academy of Science. With the final establishment of Soviet regime in 1921, the academy was renamed into the All Ukrainian Academy of Science and became subordinated to the People's Commissariat of Education, Narkompros. It also included the Ukrainian Scientific Society, what is quite important, founded with the close participation of Ukrainian historian Mikhail Hrushevsky and the Kyiv Archaeological Commission. This cultural boost and the Ukrainization of the former imperial universities immediately after the 1920s turned into their specification and decrease in status. They were transformed into institutes of public education, Institute Narodnoy Osvity, about which we will talk today actually, in order to accelerate the training of teaching staff instead of the previous focus on the fundamental science. It's very important aspect. So from the establishment of Soviet regime, the science started to be subordinated to a more like teaching aim. In 1921, it was decided to create regional research departments, so-called Nauково-дослідницькі кафедри. I didn't know how to say it in English, like research departments on the territory of Soviet Ukraine in Kharkiv and in Odessa, first of all. So already in the 1920s, a new period of construction of modern Ukrainian culture began in completely different political, ideological, socio-economical conditions than before. And of course, all it influences the landscape, cultural and intellectual landscape of the 1920s. In the 1920s, formalism and Marxism were the two main methods that were developed in Soviet Ukrainian literary criticism. As usual, researchers speak about their hostile attitude towards each other, Like, you know, there is like a good hero and the bad hero, and they battled each other. And like, unfortunately, the bad hero won. But indeed, it's not like this. And today we will try to change this perception and to look, for example, like Galin Tikhanov suggested, to look on these two methods, not as the enemies, but at their competitors for the right to be considered as the only one scientific methods. That is very important because both formal and Marxist approaches stood on the position of universalism. The Marxist approach, I'm very sorry that I may say very things that are quite understandable or known for everybody, but I will just repeat them. The Marxist approach presupposed the study of literature not as an isolated or self-contained phenomenon, but as the representation of social order and class system. Marxism proceeded from the fact that literature is one of the forms of social consciousness, the development of which reflects the class struggle. In this case, literary work is a product that is always socially conditioned and reflects the views of the certain class. The formal method initially considered literature as an immanent and autonomous field of knowledge. It means such a field that developed based on the eternal laws. And here, of course, first we should say about Апояс, Общество изучения поэтического языка in Russian, Society for the Study of Poetic Language. Here you may see one of the founders of this organization, and which begins, the history of Апояс begins in 1916 with the publication of the first periodicals, collections for the study of poetic language in Petrograd. Сборники по изучению поэтического языка. The main idea of formalism was that there is a universal key for understanding of literature. It must be interpreted through the phenomenon of defamiliarization, отстранение in Russian, through the reloading of literature depending on the context. And here I would highlight a very important aspect for our further discussion is that in Ukraine, the general recipes of formalism were used to form a new national Soviet Ukrainian literature, new literary canon or rethinking of the previous one, and to conduct a Ukrainian national identity. Universalism was understood by Ukrainian authors either as a synonym for the communist worldwideness, like avant-gardists, or for example, Mykola Khvilyuy and his supporters, or as a pseudonym for world cultural heritage, as for example, neoclassicists or Alexander Beletsky, about whom we will talk today a lot. In the 1920s, there was an attempt to fit the national project into the framework of the all-Soviet project of rapid modernization. And this, in this sense, with all its apparent simultaneous development in relation to the metropolitan center, Soviet Ukrainian culture was developing non-simultaneously, since it set itself different tasks. According to the retrospective remark of Viktor Petrov, about whom we discussed yesterday a lot, here you may see his quote on the screen. In the 1920s, Ukrainian literature, language, and literary criticism had similar tasks. Historically, the 1920s, 1930s were supposed to complete the transition from ethnographic populist positions to national ones to confirm the denial of the former and the disclosure of the latter. The people were consolidated into a nation. Overcoming provincialism in all areas of culture and social life, this is what was written on the flags of the carriers of the ideas of the new era. And here I would like to highlight the notion of provincialism. If we talk about provincialism in literature and literary history, then it was solved with the help of the technique of writing, which accordingly presupposes criticism of this technique. On this issue, the positions of critics, Marxists and non-Marxists intersect. Both the first of them and the second considered technique as a tool for rising of the level of national literature, to make it more modern, more readable, and more competitive in comparison to the Russian one, first of all. During the 1920s, a large number of discussions among formalists, so-called formalist camps, camp and Marxist took place in Russian and Ukrainian periodicals. And as a result, and that is the next very important aspect I would like we to discuss later, these controversies have had some kind of positive or productive impact on the development of the both methods. Here probably I should say that when we talk about Marxist approach of the 1920s, we should understand that it wasn't yet formed. So in the 1920s, there was the formation of this approach. And also it's interesting in our further discussion to compare, for example, Ukrainian and Russian context and the Marxist critiques and the works they were oriented towards. Marxists took on the board some of the aspects of formal theory. For example, they started to pay attention to how the work is made. I do not name the figures, yeah, but if you would ask, I will be more concrete in what I'm talking about. Formalists from the second half of the 1920s introduced the concept of literary environment, which meant literaturny byt, which meant the study of institutional forms of literature, such as history of literary groups, journals, and publishing houses. As for the Ukrainian formalism, here I should emphasize its synthetic character from the very beginning. For example, the representatives of the Kyiv neoclassicist group, about which we will talk today, represented by Mykola Zerov, Boris Yakubsky, Pavlo Filipovich on the one side, and the Kharkiv scholars such as Alexander Biletsky, Yeremia Eisenstock, or Agapi Shamrai, who would be the main heroes of Oksana Pashko's presentation. In their theoretical works, we're trying to overcome narrowness as they perceived it. So it's not from my my side, I'm calling it a narrowness of the formal method and introduce a more universalist and synthetic approach to the study of literature. That is why in their works, we could find an attempt to combine different approaches. Formalist and sociologist approaches in as in the works of neoclassicists, but also Potibnya's psychologic theory, Alexander Potibnya psychologic psycholinguistic theory, which gradually influenced Alexander Biletsky and others, for example. And here probably to finish my brief introduction, I would like to say a couple of words about Alexander Biletsky, as the two presentations are devoted to him. Today we will talk about like Kyiv context of the development of Ukrainian literary criticism. We will listen to Natalia Vusatyuk-Katenka. Another center, a very important center, was in Kharkiv, keeping also in mind that Kharkiv was the capital of Soviet Ukraine in 1919-1934. Alexander Beletsky, who from the 1912 was an assistant professor at the Department of Russian Language and Literature at Kharkiv University. He formed the group of scholars, literary scholars, who in his seminars, yeah, that's starting from 1916, but actually during the whole 1920s, yeah. And these seminars, they were very important for the development of the formalist approach, psychological approach, synthetic approach to the understanding of literature. But the main problematics of these seminars was the problem of reader or sociology of the reader. What should be also said? Yeah, here is his main works. I'm sorry, I was too lazy to translate them into Ukrainian. Hope you read a little bit Russian to English, pardon, and Ukrainian. In his 1920s works, for example, as «Новейшее течение в русской науке о литературе» or «Об одной из очередных задач историко-литературной науки», both of these articles, they devoted to the problem of the method. In the context of the flourishing and development of the formalist method, and also in the context of the discussion about like what is formalism, I mean Russian formalism, and what should be the universal approach to the understanding of literary work. But also the figure of Alexander Potivnya was extremely important for the 1920s Ukrainian literary discussions. And here probably I should say that his kind of main work that we could consider of the 1920s is his «В мастерской художника слова», where he talks about the problematics of the reader. Above of this, it's important to highlight that he was highly engaged in the study of ancient literature and in translation of ancient literature, as, for example, Kievan neoclassicists did. In 1938, the first volume of the ancient literature anthology was published. And here, for example, I also would like to emphasize his Renaissance figure, as, for example, Sherek Shevelev highlights or remembers it in his memoir, yeah? So he talks about Alexander Beletsky and the Renaissance universalist example of the scholar who knew a lot and was translated, transmissioned his knowledge to his students and to his colleagues. On the other side, Beletsky is very important as if you mentioned, yeah, he was born in Kazan, when he was just 6 years old, his family moved to Kharkiv, and his further intellectual biography connected to the Kharkiv and a little bit later from the late 1920s to Kyiv. So he was like between Kharkiv and Kyiv. So he's an example of the person who came from another culture, but in 1920s he took an active part in the formation of the Ukrainian intellectual landscape, I would say so. And here I would like to emphasize his quote taken from his autobiography written in 1945. But in general, he writes, I managed to implement my broad plans for enriching Ukrainian culture with translations of world literature only to a small extent. The example of Gorky's world literature and the book catalogs of the publishing house Academia was contagious. Every year, I deliver to Ukrainian publishing houses extensive brochures of what should have been translated. So that is the last aspect, and I will give the word to our presenters. I would like to highlight the participants of Alexander Biletsky in the this struggle for modernization of national Ukrainian culture. So. Probably I should stop here. I hope that, of course, I didn't highlight a lot of aspects, and that I hope that we will discuss them after. Oksana, the floor is yours, so you're welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello to everybody, and thank you very much, Galina, for your very interesting and important introduction and talk. It's very helpful for me to continue this test about Biletsky, and I use my presentation. Sorry. Okay, one moment. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Yes. Do you see my presentation? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Thank you very much. And now I apologize that I changed the title of my talk because now the title is The Formation of the Sociology of Literature in the Ukraine Literary Criticism on the 1920s, Only Sociology Reader Perception. Because it's very important, this theme is very important for this department and Biletsky. And as I can be honest, it's a problem of sociology of style. It's something problem for me describe and analyzes in this talk. I apologize of this confusion and I continue my talk. A sociology approach of literature to literature in the 1920s and 1930s is still under researched in Ukraine, as Galina said. Also, there is enough materials for analysis of this topic. Recently, the situation with the study of the formal methods in Ukrainian literary studies has changed very totally. The book of my colleagues, Galina Babak and Alexander Dmitriev, Atlantis of Soviet National Formalism, Formal Method in Ukraine in the 1920s, early 1930s, is published. And I am very happy that I received this book today morning. Galina, it's my surprise for you. Yes, it's very, I'm happy to receive this book. Yes, it's present for me. In this book, it reconstructs and analyzes the peculiarities of the formation and existence of the formal method in Ukraine in this period in detail, describing many personalities as examples. The key features of the development of the formal method are revealed, and the differences between the Russian and Ukrainian versions of formalism are described. And of course, in this book, much attention is paid to the work of Ukrainian scholar Biletsky and his contribution to the formation of the School of Literary Criticism in Ukraine. And so, of course, we may agree with all these theses. And in my talk, I try to reconstruct how the problem of studying a reader is developed in certain scientific institutions. It seems logical because the 1920s already demonstrate planned organization of scientific institutions. Regarding the study of a reader, we should mention three institutions. The Ukrainian Academy of Sciences, located in Kyiv, is the workplace of four well-known Ukrainian scholars, Mykola Zerov, Filipovich, Yakubsky. It will be the topic of the talk by Natalia Vusatyuk. In their works on the history and theory of literature, they repeatedly address the study of the problem of a reader. Another institution, Ukrainian Scientific Institute of Bibliology, works under the leadership of Yuri Mizhenko. Researchers actively study the problem of a reader, focusing on a cooperation with libraries and exploring the tastes of a modern reader. The third institution, the Department of Literary Studies of Kharkiv University, it was called Kharkiv Institute of People's Education, maybe headed by Alexander Bilevsky. So there are four sections in this department, theory and methodology, Ukrainian literature, Russian literature, and Western European literature. And the work of this department in the context of studying the problem of a reader is at the center of my talk report. Thus, in 1922, as Galina said, the journal Science in Ukraine published a key work by Alexander Bilevsky, «Очередной задачи историко-литературной науки». You can see the manuscript of this report on the screen. And in fact, this article is a report delivered on October 1921. It's earlier than 1922. And let's consider the main thesis of these articles. First of all, the scholar outlines general features of literary research. You can see in the presentation that in his opinion, literary research consists of four stages. First, circumstances that precede the setting of the work, from bibliography to the history of text and information about a reader as a product of the era. Second, analysis of the work in its essence, composition, plot, syllable, genre, and style. Third, place of phenomenon in the history environment, the role of tradition and the struggle against it. And fourth, result of the work as phenomenon, the influence of work on the subsequent literary process, the life of the work in the mind of the reader. And last point, the role of a reader as a participant in the literary process is a subject of more detailed analysis of the school, which allows Bilevsky to come to the conclusion that the history of the history of literature is not only the history of a writer, but also of a reader. Expands the understanding of the literary process and introduces a variety of materials into the history of literature, such as criticism, which Bilevsky considers as a history of a reader. Also, this formulation of the problem arises the need to study the so-called second-rate writers. Moreover, the scholar formulates a rather categorical thesis. For now, any attempt to establish the aesthetic value of a literary work, regardless of the question of perception of this work, fails. As it has been repeatedly noted, Bilevsky thesis that the idea of discovery by a reader creates the idea, and ideas that a writer does not suspect about, probably formulated on the basis of the theories of Alexander Potemnia. We do not develop this topic further. And also in the article of the next task, об очередной задаче историка литературной науки, mentioned above, Beletsky offers a typology of a reader. The scholar distinguishes four types of readers. First, imaginary interlocutors. Here, he relies in many respects of the articles by Osip Mandelstam. Second, contemporary readers, supporters, and different readers. Third, readers, descendants, interpreters, those who impose their ideas on writers, those who impose their own, other people's, yet later images. And fourth, readers with a pen in their hands, among which it is necessary to distinguish the following subtypes: pure readers, syntonists, and readers who demonstrate a creative approach to reading. It is important to point out the scholars on whom Beletsky relies when formulating his concept. Alexander Potibnya, Emile Henneken, Louis Magron, Jean-Marie Guillot, Robert Escarpy, and Shuking and Kummer, and Mykola Rubakin, bibliopsychology. The question arises as to why Beletsky does not mention the book by Boris Grinchenko in front of the wide, перед широким світом, in front of the wide world. This is an important work devoted to the study of a reader based on the materials of Ukrainian literature. Probably in this article, Beletsky relies primarily on the Western European literary tradition and explores the materials of Russian literature. The article by Beletsky becomes the key to the analysis of the problem of a reader in the Ukrainian literary criticism of the 1920s. Almost everyone who addresses this topic refers to this work. There is a downside of such popularity. In the early 1930s, anyone who criticizes the methods of reader research of the previous decade criticizes this work of Alexander Beletsky. Concise theoretical thesis of the scholar should be clarified and developed, and the work requires rethinking and adjustment of the material of Ukrainian literature. And this is actively done by schools and graduate students of the Department of Literary Studies, created in 1926 in Kharkiv University. Based and on archival documents, we can present the work of the department. We can determine its research profile. In the operation plan of the department, Alexander Beletsky mentions that society shows an increased interest in the issues of methodology and theory of literary criticism. The search for objective scientific criticism of literary works. Debates about the essence of literary work, about formalism and Marxism and literary criticism. All this indicates the era of reorganization of all knowledge about literature into the sociology of literature. The first glimpses of this we can find in the works of the famous Ukrainian scholar Potibnya. As the main direction of theoretical development of the department, Beletsky describes the need to form sociology of literature and to develop such issues as the sociology of a reader and sociology of style.
Оксана, я вибачаюся, я прерву. Ви папери кладете біля мікрофону, і тоді погано чутно. Ага. От просто щоб це.
Окей.
Дякую, я вибачаюся.
Thank you, Галя, дякую вам дуже. I don't know where is microphone in my computer. Thus, from the beginning, one of the key scientific issues of the department is formulated as follows. The question of sociology of literary styles. According to Bieliński, it is necessary to reconsider exciting theories, to study the artistic style in the context of the social and everyday style of the era, to study the dialectics of the literary process, patterns in the alternation of literary styles. The research focuses not only on the problem of changing styles, but also on the problem of changing genre forms. From the great novel of realism era to the small form of early 20th century modernism, as well as the problems of plot, such as the problem of creation of the plot. Also, the following issues are in the focus of attention: composition, construction, and architectonics. However, the most important topic researched by schools in the problem of sociology of literary perception. The department conducts theoretical, historical, and experimental studies of a reader. It is important to discuss theoretical developments of this topic. It provides for the study of class psychology and reader perception, as well as identification of types of readers' customers. Questions about the modern Ukrainian reader are also developed. Readers' interests are studied, in particular, the ways literary influences a reader. For example, what makes particular writers one's favorites? A separate important topic, the difference between living what pure what good what and cliché, the registration of cliché in the modern writing. So the section of theory and methodology of the Department of Literary Study is headed by Bieliński, and the following scholars are Margarita Habel, Zakhary Chuchmaryov, Boris Lezin, and in 1928, Vladimir Derzhavin starts working at the department. Postgraduate students is Alexander Rosenberg and maybe Dulenga, but Dulenga is a very big question. Was a part of this department? But it should be emphasized that not only this section of theory and methodology is dealing with the issues of methodology, but also the whole department. For example, Eisenstock and Shamrai, because Eisenstock works on Ukraine in Ukraine section, and works on Russian section, and Shamrai in Ukraine section. So the result of work are supported to be published. They plan to publish the collection of articles of methodology and theory of literature and the collection of reader studies. But we have no information about this project. I didn't know, books were published? And how is scientific process of department organized? First, regular seminars are planned, reports are prepared for the meeting of the department. Active work is carried out with graduate studies, for example. The methodological seminar on literature is led by Agapi Shamrai, and the seminar of the history of dialectical materialism is led by Volodymyr Karyak. So we can see a list of questions that students are asked to discuss in this department. Here, some of them I can read only some of them. Problems of studying the history of a reader. Memoir as a source for reader story. Correspondence as a source of reader story. Human documents, maybe we can now named as ego documents in history. Imaginary interlocutor, a class perception of literature, a petite bourgeois in any period. To what extent does the form exist for a reader? Opium books in Russian literature, what is this? I don't know. Gnat Mikhailichenko is Ukrainian writer. Gogol's metamorphosis in readers. And very interesting that there are questions which orientation for research mass literature, popular literature, Tarzan, Pinkerton, Pierre Benoit, history. Next, let's try to consider in more detail how Bielecki ideas about the need to study a reader in the context of the sociology of literary tastes of the era of Ukrainian Romanticism are reviewed. We appeal to the work of Agapi Shamrai and the Yeremia Eisenstock. In the big article Kotlerevshina from the collection of literary materials Ukrainian Propylaea, Eisenstock first expands the range of materials, analyzing not only the so-called canonical works. Eisenstock uses this term canonical, but also the so-called mass literature of the era, and etc. Second-rate, forgotten, and unknown writers. This allows the scholar to talk about the formation of the school or the imitation of writers. Gives the opportunity to study the mechanism of borrowing and allows discovering the true face of literature in a certain period. While formulation such an understanding of the literary process, the scholar relies on the works of Gornfeld, Jermonsky, especially Byron and Pushkin, Eichenbaum, Vinogradov. In the context of the study of canonical writers and mass literature, Eisenstock reflects on the problem of templates. According to him, the works of a great poet always perform surrounded by a group of literary companions, who in their own way carry out the same or similar trends and in turn are picked up by young contemporaries of poet in numerous imitations. Thus, nothing the important of studying minor writers, Eisenstock draws a logical conclusion, the need to study a reader with a pen in hand. Eisenstock believes that in the first decades of the 19th century, we can distinguish a certain literary tradition, Kotlerevshina, represented by the writers imitators. When analyzing their work, we can find out the role of a reader in the formation of Ukrainian literature of the 19th century. We do not now raise the question of the acceptability of the concept of Kotlerevshina for a literary historian, as well as who is the author of this concept, because Eisenstock believes that the authorship belongs to him and not to Mykola Zerov, as noted in the book. In any case, the scholar tries to adapt the concept of sociology of reader to the history of Ukrainian literature and emphasizes that the problem of reader is the key to the study of the history of Ukrainian literature. Another aspect of the study of reader important for Eisenstock is the study of a writer's reading circle, their library. And Eisenstock's conclusions that the interest of reader of Kotlerevsky did not go beyond the interest of the so-called readership. And this test provoked criticism from his contemporaries. But if we talk about method, then, without a doubt, Eisenstock works with the concept of sociology of reader's perception and reader's taste. Scholars discusses in more detail how to interpret the category of a reader with a pen in hand. And he characterizes a boundary between reader and writer drawn by Bieletsky. Eisenstock believes that in practice it is difficult to notice this boundary, and sometimes it is completely erased. We have two extremes. On one side, a reader with a pen does not yet exist. On the other, they no longer exist because they become a real writers. Between these extreme points lies the main mass of readers with a pen in hand, completely overlooked by Bieletsky. Eisenstock said, in my opinion, such a dialectical jump is only a certain rhetorical figure, which in fact does not explain anything, but which encouraged us to look closely at the scientific style of Eisenstock himself, at the specifics of his work with quotations and methods of compilation in his own scientific texts. But this is a topic of another research. Another research important for the study of both the history of reader and the problems of literary school and literary life is the three volumes Kharkiv Schools of Romanticism, 1920s, by Agapi Shamrai. It is illustrated, for example, by the terminological apparatus of the scholar. Literary fact, literary tradition, literary production, literary circle, cells of literature, literary life, reader perception, enthusiastic reader, formation of tastes, etc. A theoretical study of the origins of Romanticism in Ukrainian literature in the 1930s and 1940s is preceded by considerable research and textual work by the scholar. Let's analyze in more detail those articles which directly refer to problem of literary life and the role of reader in the formation of literary tastes of the era. In the article Literary Circle of Sreznevsky, the scholar reconstructs a circle of a typical form of romantic style. Quote, circles as a kind of literary cells, especially spread during the times of emergence of Romanism. Sreznevsky's circle, according to Shamrai, is an example of a circle of readers in deeply connection with the university, in Kharkiv University. This circle does not create a new literary theory, but they can popularize the influences present in the reflected reader's perception. Readers share the impressions of what they have read, experience literary news with the great emotionally, etc. According to Shamrai, one of the ways to study the peculiarities of the literary life of circle is the correspondence. So correspondence is also seen as a reflection of reader states, and the taste, according to Shamrai, is formed in the members of Sreznevsky circle under the scene of admiration for folklore. Therefore, Shamrai's work analyzes in detail the place of folk songs in the works of the first Ukrainian romantics and examines the question of modification of oral creativity in literary traditions, creation of certain commonplace, loci comuni, which will then be used in both Ukrainian and Russian literature, for example, Gogol's Taras Bulba. Literary interest in Ukrainian folklore by Ukrainian romantics Shamrai aligns with the European trends, interest in the problem of nationality, the global phenomenon in the emergence of Romantic school. He analyzes a proud figure of a Ukrainian hetman, typical for Ukrainian Romantic as a hero of Walter Scott's novel, and a Ukrainian Kobzar as a titanic image of a Northern scout. By repeating certain cliches, aesthetic selection of favorite images, ornamentation and epic presentation of folk Duma, it is important that Shamrai distinguishes between an ethnographer's approach to the study of folklore text, namely perception of literary processing of folklore material as spoiling the authentic text, as Katerina Grushevska does in the famous study Ukrainian Folk Dumas, and literary processing of folklore as the fact of literature. Thus, Shamrai, like Azishto, considers the history of Ukrainian literature through the problem of a reader with a pen in hand. But the school works with materials not of Kotlarevsky epigons, but of Ukrainian romantics, with a reader that forms circles and publishes almanacs, creates certain stamps that are important for the further development of literature. Of course, the works of Shamrai and Eisenstock, analyzed in the my talk, are only a small part of what is doing for the scientific problem of sociology of reader perception in the Department of Literary Studies. However, we have two significant works that result not only in the theoretical and historical understanding of readers' problem, but also in the introduction of new materials. And the end of the report, we want to return to the works of Alexander Beletsky himself on the issue of sociology of reader. The scholar popularized this idea and is quite active in presenting reports on a reader. For example, in 1927, Beletsky reads the report, Reader, Writer, Literature, is delivered in the Congress of the Literary Organization PUH and published it in a magazine called Plujanin. There the scholar develops a concept of imaginary reader, and not only outline a theoretical aspect, but also analyzing readers' essays collected by him and his students. As you can see on screen, this is the essays of real reader, of the 1920s. As for essays, they are extremely interesting, primarily because they show the gap that exists between the pre-revolutionary education system and the level of students who come from working and peasant backgrounds and who claim not only to study, but also to write and create their own literature. We give one reader's review, which is stored in the archives of Beletsky and most likely is prepared for the report in PLUH. This is retelling of Pushkin's little tragedy, Mozart and Salieri. So I try maybe describe quote this essay in English, maybe. it's very funny in English too. Mozart and Salieri is one of the works of Pushkin. It describes half life to musicians and they were writers. Mozart wrote poems well and Salieri wrote a little worse. And he did not bear the right well, but it didn't work out. Salieri became envious that Mozart was writing so deftly, and he managed to do it so well, and no matter how hard he worked, Everything did not work out for him, and he decided to give Mozart poison. And so he invited Mozart for a cup of vodka and decided to poison him. When Mozart came, Salieri said, "Hello, genius. Hello, I've been waiting for you for an hour," Salieri said. Mozart Andreas sat down on the chair at the table, and Salieri sat down on the chair on the other side of the table, began to drink. Mozart says, "Do you know what, brother? I want to say goodbye. My stomach hurts." Salieri says goodbye. Mozart lay down and fell asleep and began to play his instrument in such a way that Salieri cried and died at the end of the 18th century. It's a real essay of real reader. As you may remember, Pushkin describes these episodes a little differently, but we deal with reality. A very interesting feature of the life of the Department of Literary Studies at the time is the active cooperation with literary organization and public reports of various issues of literary studies in literary circles. Such circles of the 1920s are circles of non-professional writers. They often formed by an unprepared audience, a reader who picked up a pen and wants to become a writer. The Department of Literary Studies plans to cooperate both with the Vaplite literary group, whose writers proclaim a focus on the prepared reader, and with the literary organization PLUK, which focuses on a reader who had recently learned not only to write, but also to read. This connection with literary organizations and active participation in the modern literary process is also mentioned in an operation plan of department and is a necessary part of life of scholars in the 1920s. To sum up, we may say that in this talk, using the work of the Department of Literary Study of Kharkiv University as example, we try to show that the problem of studying the sociology of a reader in the 1920s in Ukrainian literary studies is actively developed in theoretical and historical terms. Types of readers, a reader is an active participant in the literary process, the problem of readers' tastes, and the formation of stylistic trends, etc. And in particular terms, education and upbringing of mass readers through the editorial policy of periodicals and publishers. Thank you for your attention. And this is my source, which I used in my presentation.
Dear Oksana, thanks a lot for your fruitful and rich presentation. And here, probably we should make a kind of 5-10 minutes pause, or what do you think? To continue to the next presentations, yeah? Okay, so let's make it for 10 minutes. So now it's 4:13. So at 4:23, we will continue with the next speaker. Yeah, thanks a lot.